All right, next question.
The name Jesus.
Yes.
I personally believe in the blood of Jesus because I've personally used that. But I hear that it's a lot of different other names for Jesus. So I want to get more clarity about that.
All right, let's see how many names God had. Give me the book of Zechariah.
Zechariah, amen.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Let's see how many names do God
Zechariah,
have.
Chapter 14.
Listen, follow me in the book of Zechariah, the 14th chapter.
And at the 9th verse.
All right, Zechariah 14 and 9. Follow me and get me. I want to soak you a little.
And the Lord shall be king over all the earth.
And the Lord shall be king over all the earth.
In that day. Shall there be one Lord.
And how many names this one Lord gonna have?
And his name, one.
Two.
One.
Three.
One.
Four.
One.
Five.
One.
Six.
His name, one.
Somebody is a liar.
That's right.
Now let me help you out, my sister. What is your name, sister? What's that?
Venus Tamer.
Tamer? Now, if you go to a foreign country, they will say your name in their language, but it won't take away from the fact it's your name.
That's right.
In Spanish, my Spanish brothers and sisters, how do you say the name Jesus in your language? Jesus, correct? It's still Jesus.
Still Jesus.
The Hebrews say Yeshua. The reason why they say Yeshua, because one, there is no J's in the Hebrew grammar. Joshua is pronounced in Hebrew, Yeshua.
Right.
Yeshua is the name Jesus in Hebrew.
That's right.
Jacob had a brother named Esau. In Arabic, Esau is pronounced Isa. Mm-hmm. Isa. In Arabic, the name Isa is Jesus. So if I say Isa, that's Jesus. Hashua, that's Jesus. Jesus, that's Jesus.
That's Jesus.
Whatever language. You see, God is an intelligent God. He know everybody that don't have one language.
In the book of Hebrew.
Listen at this quickly.
In the book of Acts, chapter 26 and at verse 13.
Acts 26, 13.
At midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven.
At midday. O king, I saw a light from heaven.
Above the brightness of the sun.
And what?
Shining round about me and them which journeyed with me.
Uh-huh.
And when we all fallen to the earth.
We fell to the earth.
I heard a voice speaking unto me.
I heard a voice speak to me.
And saying in the Hebrew tongue.
You see, he spoke to Paul in Hebrew.
Saying, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the brick.
Now a blind person would say, you see that, Pastor Jennings? Even the Lord spoke to Paul in Hebrew. Why would the Lord talk to Paul in any other language?
Right.
Why would the Lord talk to Paul in German if Paul was a Jew?
That's right.
God ain't going to talk to me in Spanish. Mm-hmm. I'm English.
Yeah.
And if God got a message for me, it's going to come in my language.
That's right.
Why? So I can understand it. For that message to be profitable, and I'll walk away with the understanding, if I'm Arabic and don't know no Hebrew, why would God talk to me in the Hebrew tongue?
That's right.
Paul was a Benjamite.
Mm-hmm.
He was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. So the Lord spoke to him
in the Hebrew tongue
and said, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And Saul said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am
Jesus.
So in Hebrew, the Lord said, I'm Yeshua.
Yeshua.
But in English, he said, I'm Jesus. So yes, we preach in the name of Yeshua. We preach in the name of Isa. We preach in the name of Jesus. We preach in the name to the English folk, Jesus.
Be it known unto you all.
Yeah. That's right. Don't you hear Jesus told his apostles, go ye into all the world. You think the Lord going to give them a command like that if everybody spoke one language?
That's right.
He's not going to do that.
No.
My God, he's going to give the apostles, hey, give me the 19th chapter of the book of Psalms, if you will.
Yeah.
The Bible says there is no speech.
Mm-hmm.
No language.
Where their voice is not heard.
I want you to show you this.
Psalms 19, we'll start at verse 1.
Listen.
The heavens declare the glory of God.
The heavens declare the glory of God.
And the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech.
And night unto night showeth knowledge.
There is no speech. Nor language. Where their voice is not heard.
Everywhere the apostles went, they brought it in all type of languages and all type of speeches so people can get the word of God. The line is going out to all the earth.
And the words to the end of the world.
Whatever your language is. God have a way of bringing his name and his word to you. That's all right, next question.
Oh, it's me?
Come on, brother.
Oh, all right. In Acts chapter 16, verse 14, what did it mean when the Lord opened the heart of Lydia when she attended to what Paul spoke?
Yes. All right, Acts.
Chapter 16 and at verse 14.
Uh-huh.
And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple,
uh-huh,
of the city of Thyatira, which worshiped God,
yes,
heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul.
The Bible said that her heart was opened. Then the Bible gave you the reason.
Which worshiped God heard us.
Yes.
Which the Lord opened.
And
that she attended.
She attended.
Unto the things which were spoken of Paul.
You see, the Apostle Paul was preaching the word of God and Lydia's heart got open. And when her heart came open, she accepted.
That's
letting
right.
You know, in order for the word of God to be profitable unto you, you've got to receive it with the open heart.
Open
when
heart.
You have an open heart, you will submit yourself to it and you will obey it.
That's right. Whose heart the Lord opened.
Who opened it?
The Lord opened.
God can move on me to preach it, but God got to deal with your heart.
That's right.
Eh?
That's right.
God can move on me to tell you what he said, but God does the work on your heart.
Mm-hmm.
My God, when the God of heaven, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, when he work on your heart, I won't have no problems getting you in water in the name of Jesus Christ.
And when she was baptized.
Don't you hear the word of God said? The Bible said when they heard this, they were pricked. They were pricked in their heart. And said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? And he commanded all of them to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. So when Lydia's heart came open, that means she was receptive to God's everlasting word. And I'm pretty sure that's why y'all here today, because your heart came open.
Oh, yeah.
Amen. If your heart wasn't open, you wouldn't be here. All right, next question.
Pastor, before I'm baptized, I wanted to know, how often does God allow us to repent of the same sin before he's just kind of done with us over it?
How often? That's the same question that they asked Jesus.
Yeah.
How many times
That's right.
do I forgive my brother? That's why the Bible says he's long suffering to us with. How many times do I forgive my brethren? Jesus began to tell him when seven times, seven Passover. So as long as you live and there's mercy, God will forgive you long as you fall on the mercy of God. But at the same time, we don't want to become comfortable in our sins and use God's mercy for granted, because a lot of preachers preach that God's mercy can't run out. Yes, it can.
Yes, it can.
The Bible said God will have mercy on whom he will have mercy.
In the book of St. Matthew, chapter 18.
Matthew 18.
I read verse 21.
Listen.
Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him?
Yes.
Till seven times?
Till seven times.
Jesus saith unto him.
Notice Peter threw out one number.
Seven times.
All right.
Jesus saith unto him.
Jesus said to him,
I say not unto thee until seven times.
No, not just seven times.
But until 70 times seven.
Until 70 times seven.
Times seven.
So when you go before God and you do fall in sin, now true repentance is not just saying I'm sorry. Anybody can say I'm sorry. True repentance is when your heart is convicted. And when your heart is convicted, you want to surrender what you're doing. Now, one thing about sin, sin works in favor of your flesh. That's why you struggle with it so much, and you don't want to give it up. And you got to have a preacher that constantly work on your flesh.
Yeah.
And that's why a lot of folk don't like Pastor Jennings, because I'm an anti-flesh killer.
That's right.
Eh?
Yeah.
We come along with the Bible and break up your folly ground and break up your sin and speak against your wickedness. You want to shoot dice. You want to shoot pool. You want to smoke weed for municipal purposes.
That's right.
Amen. You want to dye your hair and wear somebody else's hair and wear your fake eyelashes and wear ankle chains and lipstick and be homosexuals and men marry men and women marry women and play the lottery and men with long hair like women.
Yeah.
You want to do that. Here I come with the lawnmower of the scripture, cutting every weed of wickedness with God's everlasting word. You got to have a preacher. When you got a preacher that stay on you with God's word, it helps you to overcome. But when you follow these sugar daddy preachers that got a congregation of sugar babies, you become comfortable in your sins and you are dying, go to hell, God knows.
Now I rejoice.
What is that?
Now I rejoice.
Yes, chapter and verse.
In the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and at verse 9.
I rejoice.
Not that she were made sorry.
Not that she was made sorry.
But that she sorrowed to repentance.
God, that she sorrowed unto repentance.
For you were made sorry after a godly manner.
You was made sorry after a godly manner.
That you might receive damage by us in nothing.
That you may receive damage by us in nothing.
For godly sorrow.
Godly sorrow worketh repentance to what direction?
To salvation.
Ah. Amen. Everything in here wants to be sorry about their sins. Then let's get an understanding. Once you repent of your sins and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, you're not going to be perfect.
No.
That's why you got to be taught.
That's right.
There's a lot of things we don't know is wrong. It's like a child. No child, no woman came into the delivery room and that child walked out of her womb.
Come on.
No. Come on, Pastor. Me and my wife got 7 kids. None walked out.
No.
If they would have walked out, I would have walked out. And then if you look at the development of a child, what is the first thing that form of a child in the womb of the mother? It's the head. What is the first thing that comes from the womb of the woman? And the rest of the body need help. The birth of the child represents the condition of man.
Come on.
The first thing that we need deliverance from is our mind. Are you listening? That's why the word of God work on reshaping the mind.
Right.
You change a person's thought process, it'll change their heart. Once the mind change, heart change. Once heart change, your physical behavior change.
That's right.
And when your physical behavior change, you'll show forth a pattern of good works.
Right.
So now the mind is the first thing that needs to be delivered from the sinful world of darkness. And as a child need help to bring the rest of the body from the womb of the woman, we need help as we need deliverance to come from the womb of sin. As the doctor is there to help the child to come out, God is there to help us to come out of sin. Are you listening?
Yeah.
All right, next question.
Hey, my question is, if a man divorces his first wife and marries his second wife, and his first wife dies, do he have to remarry his second wife?
All right, let's get the 7th chapter of the book of Romans, if you please.
Romans chapter 7, we're starting at verse 1.
Yes.
Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law.
That what?
How that the law hath dominion over man as long as he liveth.
The question is, when you got your second one, was she really yours to begin with? Ask the question.
Amen.
When you got your second one, was it really yours in the eyes of God?
That's right.
All right.
Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law.
Uh-huh.
How that the law hath dominion over man as long as he liveth.
Yes.
For the woman which hath an husband.
The woman. Now, this scripture always make people tip out early. The woman that have a husband
is bound by the law to her husband.
Is bound by the law to her husband.
So long as he liveth.
All right.
But if the husband be dead.
If the husband be in prison.
If the husband be dead.
Weak.
Dead.
Blind.
Dead.
Drunk.
Dead.
Suck cigarettes.
Dead.
Short.
Dead.
Lose his teeth.
Dead.
Lose one eye.
Dead.
Deaf.
Dead.
Deaf.
Dead.
Deaf.
Dead.
If the husband be dying.
Dead.
You got to be dead.
Dead.
All right.
But if the husband be dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband.
Yes.
So then if.
Here now.
So then if.
Here's the puncher right here. If.
While her husband lives.
While her husband is alive. She's married to another man.
She shall be called an adulteress.
No, she shall be called a Christian.
She shall be called an adulteress.
No, a Christian.
An adulteress.
What about she's on the choir?
She shall be called an adulteress.
A usher.
An adulteress.
Organ player.
An adulteress.
Organ choir director.
An adulteress.
If you got your second wife while your first wife was living, that's not your wife.
That's right. That's right.
So when your first wife died, your second marriage is not recognizable in the eyes of God.
That's right.
For it to be recognizable in the eyes of God, you can't get married again until the first one died.
Yeah.
So if the first one was alive when you got the second one, you got to repent for that adultery. And then when the first one died, you got to marry the second one so God can recognize it.
That's right.
And you're not supposed to marry her while the first one living. Living.
That's right. Hallelujah.
Next question. Come on, brothers.
I like to ask about the day and time that we're living in with all this artificial intelligence and virtual reality and all of this.
Mm-hmm.
We get bombarded with all these phone calls about you owe people that you really don't owe anything.
Mm-hmm.
And the person you owe ain't asking and you can't get them to agree on nothing. How are we going to handle that when they take it and sell your name and your information? Then they want to take you to court. When you want to make a complaint, you can't even get the police or anything. And I've been here 66, almost 67 years.
Uh-huh.
I used to pay all them fees for when they broke in my house and vandalized my cars. I ain't run out here and chase nobody down and give their name all over town and all over the world. And nobody brought my stuff back. But they want to bring me and accuse me of things. And then you can't even get the real person that you owe. So
well,
how can we do that, especially if they've already died too?
And they already died?
No, some people are already gone, but you had a debt.
Yeah, you can't pay them.
Okay. I just want to know how we handle that.
Yeah, if you manage to pay them, I want to know how you hook that up. The word of God says...
In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 7, we're at verse 29.
All right.
Lord, this only have I found.
Now, look, we're going to need... If we got any more extra mics, we're going to need... We don't have any more extra mics. So, your brothers, please look at... On both sides, front, back, everywhere. And I need you to let me know when you give a microphone to somebody so I can know where I'm looking at. All right, give chapter verse again, please.
In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 7 and verse 29.
Everybody all right? All right, come on.
Though this only have I found.
This only have I found.
That God hath made man upright.
Yes.
But they have sought out many inventions.
They have sought out many inventions.
Many inventions.
All right, yes, they got many inventions out here, social media and all this other stuff. But the Bible says, oh, no man. And when the Bible says, oh, no man, all you can do is make an effort to pay back who you owe.
Owe no man anything.
The Bible says.
In the book of Romans chapter 13 and that verse 8.
Do what?
Owe no man anything.
Owe no man anything.
But to love one another.
But to love one another. So if you know someone and you owe them something, then just pay it back. Otherwise than that, I can. The Bible says it shall proceed no further. You're going to have all these inventions because the Bible prophesied.
That's right.
All these inventions going to come about.
They have sought out many inventions.
The Bible says they have sought out many inventions. Many and there's many evil inventions also.
Yeah.
All right. Next question.
I know we got to be obedient about the hair covering, but I'm kind of confused about the hair covering.
All right, 11th chapter, 1 Corinthians, if you will.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, we'll start at verse 1.
All right.
Be followers of me, even as I also am of Christ.
Yes.
Now I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in all things.
Yes.
And keep the ordinances as I delivered them to you.
All right.
But I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ.
The head of every man is Christ.
And the head of the woman is the man.
And the head of the woman is the man.
And the head of Christ is God.
Yes.
Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered.
Praying or prophesying.
Having his head covered.
His head covered.
Dishonoreth his head.
You see the Muslims and many of the Jews praying with their head covered.
Covered.
They'd be at the wall. When you pray with your head covered, brother, how do God take it?
Dishonoreth his head.
You dishonor God.
That's right. Dishonor.
All right.
But every woman.
Uh-oh.
But every woman.
Every woman.
That prays or prophesies with her head.
You pray or prophesy or was dealing with worship.
Mm-hmm.
And you got your head uncovered.
Uncovered. Dishonoreth her head.
And remember the Bible said the head of every woman is the man. Now, let's get the verse where preachers have made a mess.
Mm-hmm.
About covering. Come on, son. Bible says your hair is your covering. Let's read that.
In the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 at verse 15.
All right.
But if a woman have long hair.
Now, I want to show you this real good because dumb preachers, ignorant, deceive of their close relative, the devil.
Yeah.
Have told women, you ain't got to have nothing on your head because of this scripture.
Yeah.
Listen.
But if a woman have long hair.
If a woman have long hair.
It is a glory to her.
Why?
For her hair is given her for a covering.
A covering, but it didn't say a cover.
No.
Covering.
Covering.
And covered is two different things.
That's right.
If me and some brothers is working in here and we lay in carpet. And you say, hey, Pastor Jenner, what y'all doing? I'm covering the floor. That means it's incomplete. And I say, sis, come on back in 30 minutes. And you come back and say, oh, the floor is covered, complete.
That's right.
When you got a daughter, it's cold outside, wintertime. Mama want to go out there and play. Girl, cover your head. It's cold out there. You ain't tell her put hair on.
No.
Her hair is a covering.
Ring.
But you told her put something on her covering because she's bareheaded, yet she has hair.
That's right.
Her hair is a covering, but a covering is uncovered, so the woman must cover her covering.
That's right.
Go ahead, Pastor.
The dumb preachers. Preacher tell her, women, you ain't got to cover your head. That's a dumb preacher. The Bible speaks plain. For if she pray or prophesy with her head uncovered.
Dishonoreth her head.
You think Paul was going around telling women put hair on?
Mm.
No, Walgreens and CVS is doing that for you.
That's right.
Your hair is a covering.
Covering.
But when you worship God, you cover the covering.
That's right.
Because when you cover, that shows honor.
That's right.
To men on earth, and it shows respect to the angels in heaven.
For this cause,
give chapter and verse.
1 Corinthians chapter 11 and at verse 10.
For this reason,
ought the woman to have power on her head.
For what reason?
Because of the angels.
Brother, when that woman got her head covered, it shows respect to the angels.
That's right.
Because the angels bear the shape of man.
That's right.
And that's why the Bible said the head of every woman is the man. So yes, your hair is a covering, but covering means incomplete. So when we finish covering this floor, then the floor will be covered.
That's
you
right.
Are born with a covering, but your covering is bare. That's why you must cover the covering.
That's right. For if the woman be not covered,
if the Bible speak plain,
1 Corinthians chapter 11 and at verse 6,
if the woman do not
be covered, let her also be shorn.
Let her also be shorn.
But if it be a shame, for a woman to be shorn or shaven,
then what?
Let her be covered.
Covered and covering. Those two words the preachers overlook.
That's right.
So you got to have your head covered. That shows honor and respect towards man and honor and respect towards God. Next question.
My question is about the facial hair, because I used to go to a church where he told us if we didn't have a fresh, clean shave, we were going to go to hell. And I was trying to see if there were any clarifications on the facial hair.
You was taught that if you don't have a clean shave, you're going to hell? It's not even a half a scripture that teach that.
No.
Not. Never mind a whole scripture. It's not even a half a scripture. This is the problem with churches. Bishop has implemented his own idea. And then he has taught for doctrine the commandments of men.
That's right.
When you teach for doctrine, now there's nothing wrong with having church rules. But those rules cannot contradict scripture.
Yeah.
If the preacher make a rule, we're going to ask all the brothers to be clean shaved. All right. But don't try to make it doctrine and say, if you're not clean shaved, you're going to hell.
That's right.
You see, doctrine is when I tell men, all right, no long hair.
No long hair.
That's doctrine.
Yeah. There was not even nature itself
teaching. The Bible says in the 11th chapter, 1 Corinthians.
And at verse 14.
Doeth not nature itself teach you?
That if a man have long hair.
Long hair.
It is a shame unto him.
It's a shame unto him.
Unto him.
Mm-hmm. That's why our brothers cut their hair. We ain't walking around with long hair. We're not walking around with long hair, throwing our hair back like sisters.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
So when I teach about a brother not having long hair, I got to go to the Bible when I make doctrine. But if I come along and tell my brothers, all right, even if you got a beard, let's keep yourself clean and neat and don't have your beard straggly looking like you laying out there in the street for about 20 years, then I'm implementing rule. And as I have to make it plain and let the brothers know, all right, I don't have Bible for such and such and such of this, but this is a rule that I'm implementing. But if I say you're going to hell for it, no, you're only going to hell for what God said you're going to hell for.
In the book of
Not for the way some happy bishop feel.
That's right.
All right.
In the book of St. Mark, chapter 7, and that verse 7.
All right.
Howbeit in vain do they worship me.
Yes.
Teaching for doctrine.
You see, when they tell you you're going to hell for something, they're saying that you're going to hell for something that violates doctrine. Doctrine won't change because doctrine is written.
That's right.
The Bible said they teach for doctrine.
The commandments of men.
The commandments of men. So no, the Bible don't say you'll go to hell if you're not clean shaven. Many of the old prophets, I believe Aaron, the Bible talk about Aaron had a beard so long. So the Bible don't say that you'll go to hell if you're not clean shaven on your face. All right.
We were in the same church, which was apostolic, and it was... they beat you up with that scripture, obedience is better than sacrifice. So if you don't obey the, you know, the doctrine, that you'll go to hell. Same thing is when, my question was to clarify that when I received the Holy Ghost and God had told me to leave the church and I went to the pastor and let him know that I was leaving the church, it was, well, I'm going to hell because I'm not going to get truth anywhere else. And, you know, and I know there's no condemnation, those that are in Christ, and I knew that for me, but it's just, you know, everybody's scared to leave the church because of, you're going to go to hell if you don't stay here and under this teaching.
It's scare tactics. Now, you'll go to hell if you don't be under the teaching of God's word that he gave his apostles.
Acts 2:42.
The Bible said it continues steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine without question. Me and anybody else. If we don't continue in the doctrine of the apostles, which is the teaching of Jesus, you'll go to hell. Preachers try to make it their church.
Go ahead, Pastor.
So they say, if you leave my church, hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it. That's why I tell the people, don't ever say, I'm going to Pastor Jennings' church. No, you ain't.
No.
But you put that lie on me.
That's right.
Jesus said.
Matthew chapter 16 and at verse 18.
Matthew 16 and 18 says.
And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter.
Thou art Peter.
And upon this rock.
And upon this rock.
I will build my church.
That's why the church cannot be named after the pastor. That's right. Oh, you don't like that, do you? The church can't, a lot of folk go to church, Bishop Reagan's temple, Bishop John's Memorial Temple, Evergreen Baptist Church, Church of the Open Doors, Church of the Go-Karts. They got all kind of names.
That's right.
Jesus said, upon this rock I'll build my church.
My church.
The church must be named after the one that built it.
That's right.
That's why it's the church of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm telling the world who built this church.
Upon this rock I will build my church.
I will do what?
I will build my church.
Go ahead. Okay, yeah, it ain't Pastor Jennings' church, and I'm not the founder.
That's right.
I didn't start the church. I can't put you in it. Holy Ghost put you in the church.
Right.
Bible said you're baptized by one spirit into one body. There is nobody in the Bible that professed to be apostolic. Jesus had never thought enough of the prophets or the apostles to name his belief after them.
That's right.
Never. You that walk around apostolic, Baptist, and all that stuff. Ain't none of that stuff in the Bible. The Lord ain't told you to be that. The Lord told you to be holy. I had a bishop write me, he's supposed to be apostolic, and he wanted to debate me on this. I told him I advise you to think first before you step in a square circle. You think first. He said, he said, I believe you got to be holy. He said, but there's nowhere in the Bible where the one faith was called holy. Give me the book of Jude.
In the book of Jude, chapter 1 and at verse 20.
Listen, Jude is right next to Revelation. Only got one chapter. Shouldn't be hard to find it.
That's right.
The faith. There is no such thing. Hear me, Houston. No such thing. And you television viewers, hard head, stubborn Texas longhorns. There is no such thing as a faith called apostolic, as a faith called Baptist, as a faith called Pentecostal, as a faith called non-denominational. There is no such thing. We've been lied to for years. For years. It's scary when you think of it. All this money we done gave, been loyal, helped build churches. I want to open your eyes so you can make your exodus out of these churches.
Amen.
Let's see the name of the faith. Wait a minute before you read that. First, let's see how many faiths it is in Ephesians 4 or 5.
One Lord.
How many lords?
One Lord.
How many lords?
One Lord.
No, three. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost.
One Lord.
Come on. What's the problem, Ron? Is it where I'm at? Too many microphones? Just static? All right. All right. We'll try to fight our way through it anyway.
One Lord.
One Lord.
One faith.
Now, if this message offends anybody, you come on back tomorrow at 11 o'clock. We'll pick up where we left off. One Lord.
One faith.
How many faiths?
One faith.
What did the word faith mean, Houston? It mean what?
Belief.
It mean what?
Belief.
It mean belief. So, one Lord.
One
and
faith.
How many beliefs?
One faith.
How many baptisms?
One baptism.
Now, give me the book of Jude. Let's see the name that the Bible addressed this faith.
Now, Jude chapter 1 and that verse 20.
Yes.
But ye beloved.
That's talking to the church.
But ye beloved.
Ye beloved.
Building up yourselves.
Building up yourselves.
On your most.
On your most apostolic faith.
Your most holy faith.
Go ahead, Pastor.
Wait. You got glasses. Read that right.
But ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most.
Baptist faith.
Holy faith.
Jehovah's Witness faith.
Holy faith.
Pentecostal faith.
Holy faith.
Lutheran faith.
Holy faith.
Christian Scientist faith.
Holy faith.
Non-denominational faith.
Holy faith.
Somebody is wrong and it ain't the Bible.
That's right.
Somebody is wrong and it's not the Bible.
One faith.
And I challenge any preacher in the whole state of Texas to show me your faith, the name of it, in this Bible. Other than holy.
Holy faith.
I read that God, we got the best thing on the market.
That's right.
Eh?
That's right.
We got the, hallelujah, glory to God. We got the best thing on the market.
That's right.
It's a good feeling to be able to go to the Bible and find your faith in the Bible besides just shooting off at the mouth, professing something that ain't never been in the Bible.
Amen.
Go ahead,
Beth. We've been lied to for years. Yeah. But one thing I thank God for his mercy, when you sincere, God will not let you die without hearing the right thing first.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.